Hello everyone, welcome to St. Hugh and St. John's and welcome to our service, especially if you find us by accident on YouTube. We say together the words in bold. Hello, I'm not too proud, I'm not ashamed, no need to hide my face. I'm just standing here just as I am, in my own little space. Hello, God, I like being here with you, with all these other people. So we take a moment to think about those things that we would like to say sorry for. And together we say our confession. Father God, we are sorry for the things we do and say and think which make you sad, and for not thinking of others before ourselves. Please forgive us and help us to love you and other people more and more. Amen. When we truly say we're sorry, God promises to forgive us. May the God of love bring us back to himself, forgive us our sins and assure us of his eternal love. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I wonder, have you ever been asked to do something and thought, I can't do that? Maybe something at school? Maybe at work? Or maybe you've been told that you can't do something because it just isn't your skill set. Or maybe somebody has said to you, I've never imagined that you in that sort of role. Sometimes all it takes for us to change our perspective from things that we can't do to the things that we can is a change of view. I've got some pictures here on perspective. I wonder, what do you see? So what do you see? Do you see a man playing an instrument, or do you see a woman? Do you see a vase, or do you see two faces? Do you see a frog or a horse? Do you see a donkey or a seal? What do you see? An old man sleeping or the back of a young girl's head? Do you see some flowers and a butterfly? Or do you see a girl's face? Do you see a duck? Or do you see a rabbit? Can you see Wolverine? Or can you see two Batmen? Because once one of these gets into your head, it's really difficult to change our perspective and to see something else. And we're going to think about that this morning. So I'm going to read to you from Mark chapter 6, starting at verse 1. Jesus came to his hometown of Nazareth, On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many people who heard him were amazed at what he was saying. They said to each other, "Isn't this the carpenter, Mary's son? His brothers and sisters are here too. How did he get wisdom from God? And how can he do miracles?" They were angry with Jesus for coming to the synagogue to teach them. Jesus said, "People who speak God's truth are respected, but not in their hometown or even in their own family." And he could do no miracles there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Jesus went out into the villages to teach people. He called his 12 disciples together and sent them out two by two. He gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He told them to take nothing extra with them to make their journey easier, like bread or a bag or money, but to rely on the people they stayed with to look after them. He said, "Whenever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you, if they refuse to listen as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a sign that they have ignored you." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many unclean spirits and anointed many sick people with oil and cured them. So that Bible story has got two distinct parts. The first is Jesus standing up in Nazareth, where he grew up, where everybody knows him and his family. And he reads from the passage from the Torah and speaks about it. It was his right as a Jewish man to do this. I wonder how Jesus felt standing there in front of all those people who had known him since he was a baby. Did he feel vulnerable, sticking his head up above the parapet and daring to speak of God? And they were amazed at what he said. But he can't say amazing things, can he? But he's Mary's son. Notice that he's Mary's son, not Joseph's. Maybe he can't say amazing things because there's a question mark over his birth. But he made the feeding trough for my goats. Nobody who's good with their hands can say amazing things, can they? He grew up in this village, went to school with our boys. People from around here just don't say amazing things, do they? What gives him the right to talk about God in that amazing way? And really, he can do miracles. He's just one of us, isn't he? And so Nazareth rejects Jesus. He no longer fits into that little box that they placed him in. He comes back with a reputation well known as a preacher and a healer. But it seems he can only do very few miracles here. Don't you find that a little odd, that he can't do miracles, that somehow God's power is curtailed? When people ask Jesus for healing, invariably he says, "Your faith has healed you." Jesus always healed in the context of relationship and restoring people to community. But these people, it seems, no longer recognize Jesus as part of their community. They are so stuck with the Jesus they thought they knew, they can't think of him as any different. God never bullies, coerces, or forces us. And although God could choose to work without us, God chooses instead to work with us. Jesus says, "Your faith has saved you." And I say, but didn't you just save me, God? And God says, no, I worked with you and your faith has saved you. Maybe we too put Jesus in a box, confine him to our own small, narrow view of the world. Last week, looking at the weather forecast for Sunday every 5 minutes and praying like mad, I had to keep reminding myself that 40% chance of rain meant 60% chance of not raining. Maybe I put God in a box. So, as at last week, St. Hugh and St. John's and all those listening and watching, we've got to have faith. Faith that God will work in us and change our perspective. Faith that God will work with us and not without us. So the second half of this talk, of this reading. Every time somebody volunteers to put their head above the parapet in church and read or welcome or join the singing group or lead prayers or say hello to someone new, every time you smile at somebody in the queue at Asda or invite someone around for coffee or phone someone up, or put your hand up to answer a question, you make yourself vulnerable. Vulnerable to be laughed at or rejected or thought to be a bit uppity. All those were things that Jesus also made himself. Imagine if coming to know God in the way that he did, Jesus hung about at the back of the synagogue and said, no, don't choose me. I'm not good enough. I'm not brave enough. One of the lovely things that happens in our church in August is that the young people take a much more active part at 10 o'clock. And especially when they choose to lead, they do it with such grace and assurance. And I always look at them and think, would I have been brave enough at 8 to help lead church? One of my dad's favourite sayings is, it's okay to be scared. Just don't let being scared stop you doing stuff. God doesn't ask us to be vulnerable to each other and the world for the sake of it or to feel small. It is often when we feel most vulnerable that we become aware of how supported we are by God and other people. Maybe it's not so much the bit about God asking us to do stuff, as the bits that sometimes we have to ask others for help. I wonder if any of you have watched The Mission. I watched it when it first came out, and I've never been able to watch it again because it made me cry so much. Gabriel, a Jesuit priest and missionary, enters the jungle to preach to the Guarani community who lived in Paraguay. The tribe had always been violently hostile to outsiders, but Gabriel decides to go alone with his oboe, hoping that the music will reach them and touch them. He makes a difficult journey through jungle and across rivers and up mountains, and when he catches sight of some of the tribesmen, he begins to play. The Guaranis creep close in, drawn by the magical sound. However, one tribe member becomes angry and grabs the oboe and breaks it. Another gestures for Gabriel to carry on playing, but Gabriel gestures back and says, it's broken. The tribesman goes over and looks at it and then calls Gabriel to follow him. And he takes him back to the village and he fixes it. This is the true start of the mission, when Gabriel is in need and the Guarani people can and do help him. Of course, it takes a lot longer for them to trust and accept him, and longer still before they're open to his gospel message. But this, that point, when they help him and he accepts help, is where it all began. It is like the moment that the disciples entering a village ask for hospitality and make themselves vulnerable, trusting in God's grace and getting alongside people, getting to know them. Because once you are trusted and respected, people may want to hear what you have to say. Sometimes, you know, we think it's all up to us, but really it's all about God. God is already at work in the world and we just have to join in. Lots of us love Zoom, but lots also said how much they valued being in the church building. Sheila Cassidy was a doctor and a writer and wrote, "God is no more present in church than in a drinking bar, but we generally are more present to God in church than we are in a drinking bar." The problem of God's presence and recognizing it is not to do with God, but with us. Those 12 disciples, how vulnerable must they have felt being sent out by Jesus? How easy it must have been to praise God and recognize God when you had Jesus right by your side, pointing out the lilies of the field and the widow searching for her lost coin. How easy is it for us as a church to talk about mission and our mission action plan and community here in the safety of this church, with Jesus slap bang in front of us. But this means nothing if we don't then also see God out those church doors. Our work as a church starts when we leave this building. Us, the body of Christ, is called to recognize God at work in Chells and Chells Manor and beyond and join in. And so we come to our prayers. And we're going to use a series of pictures and at the end I'm going to play Gabriel's oboe from the mission. So the first picture is about being vulnerable. Jesus stood up and made himself vulnerable and invited the disciples to make themselves vulnerable in relying totally on God. Lots of us have felt a little lost and vulnerable this past year. So some space to pray for us, for ourselves, for those we know who struggle and are vulnerable. Second picture is all about stuff. Jesus sent the disciples out, having to rely completely on God for food and lodging. So some space to pray for all those with less than us, to pray for the people that they rely on, to pray for all those who offer food and shelter and a welcome. and a picture of a dusty road. Sometimes this is what life feels like. Dry and dusty, no life. And things don't go well, and it's hard to trust. And especially hard to trust God. So we pray for all those who struggle to trust God. All those who struggle in mind, body, and spirit. We end our prayers by praying together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. So, whether we're at home, or whether we're somewhere else, We are sent out by God. We go into the world to walk in God's light, to rejoice in God's love, and to reflect God's glory. Amen.